McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Communication Intelligence. Leverage your strengths and optimize every interaction to work best with others. By Claude DeVal Morgan. Narrated by Jim Denison. Publisher's note. This audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All exercises and examples referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. Communication is the number one needed competency in the world of work today and for the foreseeable future. I've been passionate about communication intelligence since I was a kid, although I didn't know the term for it then. I did know that I was intently curious about people and how they interact. While in elementary school, I would walk home, stopping along the way to visit with neighbors and learn about their lives. As a student reporter for the local newspaper, I had a more formal process to document and share stories of human interest. When I graduated to the world of work at the local television station, my interest in how people communicate grew, and so did my list of questions. Do individuals recognize the overwhelming impact that communication has on all aspects of work and life? Are people aware that they have different styles of communicating? Do they grasp how others perceive their messages and intended meaning? Is there a way to document the impact that communication has on employees, customers, teams, and an organization's bottom line? Is it possible to help individuals, teams, and organizations achieve their full potential and be their best by focusing on communication? These are just some of the many questions I had on my mind throughout my personal life, but more so in my career. At the TV station, I had the privilege of working with a diverse group of talented individuals on our core team. Allow me to introduce you to a few of them and their styles of communicating. John was the news anchor. He was outgoing and friendly and talked enthusiastically about everything. He was persuasive and able to convince almost anyone into giving an interview. All about action. He really lit up when a viewer stopped him on the street to compliment a broadcast. John was the ultimate collaborator and mixed in well with almost everybody. Judy was the administrative assistant. She was patient and understanding, methodical in her work, and dedicated to doing whatever she could to help the team. She took time to explain every detail and asked a lot of questions. I don't think she ever met a person she didn't like, and she certainly never had an enemy. She confided to me that she felt constantly under pressure and had a sense of urgency that others didn't seem to get. They never have gotten me, she said, and I wonder if they ever will. Brian, the cameraman, was precise and accurate in everything he did and said. You could always depend on Brian. He admitted to being a bit of a perfectionist and wanted to get it right the first time. He tried hard to fit into the fast-paced, mostly unpredictable cycle of news breaking and reporting, but said he was more comfortable with a consistent, stable environment. He was dedicated to finishing what he started, which wasn't always possible, and sometimes felt like he was letting the team down. "I like to follow rules," he would say with a smile, hiding what I sensed was unease. Simone, the producer, was all about results. She began every staff meeting with a new idea, a new story, a new angle. She set the bar high for the team and was full of positive things to say, as long as the members of the team were meeting her goals. When they weren't, she could be direct and didn't sugarcoat her displeasure. "Why can't they pick up the pace? And why can't they follow the game plan?" she would ask. "We have a news show to put on." Even though I really enjoyed working with all these people, I struggled much of the time for them to understand what I was trying to communicate. At work, I wanted to be a more effective team member. As I looked around the studio, a line from the 1967 Academy Award-winning movie, Cool Hand Luke, came to mind. "What we've got here is a failure to communicate." One of the more serious implications of the lack of communication is the lack of trust especially a misunderstanding that has occurred multiple times. We all know it's difficult to repair the damage that a lack of trust does to relationships in our personal and business lives. So I started to ask myself, was this just the way it has always been in every workplace and was always meant to be? Jeff Weiner, CEO of LinkedIn, says that communications skills are the number one skills gap in the marketplace, which means that so many people have indeed always struggled with communication. This is not going to change anytime soon in the world of work today unless we take steps to change it. The mission, communication intelligence. It wasn't long before my passion for communication intelligence became a mission to create a system for individuals, teams, and leaders at all levels to achieve their full potential when it comes to interacting. The foundation would be a survey to identify communication style strengths. It would be efficient, effective, accurate, and easy to navigate. Ultimately, the Forte survey would take less than 8 minutes to complete, and the Forte Communication Style Profile would be immediately available, and it would be easy to understand with clear, actionable suggestions to get the message across. Especially today, who has 30 minutes to complete a survey, let alone longer than that? The point is for the Forte survey to be as convenient and impactful as possible. My aptitude for research and technology and my academic background in business administration and psychology kicked in. For over a decade, I reviewed more than 200 communication instruments and the works of the founders and pioneers in communication theory and assessment. These included Peter Marc Roget, as in Roget's Thesaurus, Francis Galton, the founder of psychometrics, Raymond Cattell, the British expert on intrapersonal psychological structure, Hans Eysenck, the German-born expert on intelligence and personality, Carl Jung, the founder of analytical psychology, Albert Alport, a pioneer in personality research, and more. While their contributions were invaluable, the technology existed to make the ease of use exceptional and the validity high, and I felt the skills were in place for me to develop what is now Forte. Building on the work of these giants, and with the help of friends and colleagues along the way, I developed a statistically validated communication style profile survey that was years in the making and remains a process improvement effort to this day. Bottom line, life goes on, and technology has evolved, so it seems, with the speed of light. Every day, we receive and review Forte validation reports from our users. The day after a Forte survey is completed, the users receive a validation request email asking them to rate the validity of their Forte and add any additional comments or suggestions they may have. So just as we evolve over time, so does Forte. Lightbulb moment. In 1981, the Forte Communications Style Survey was launched. Forte, of course, is the French word for a thing at which someone excels, or in this case, a person's communication style strengths. As the Forte system was rolled out, both the business and the development model included and sought ongoing feedback from our users so the science would remain current and relevant, and not the product of a time gone by. Soon, people began telling us how the system was a game changer for individuals, teams, and organizations. This helped us to identify, improve, and strategically use our communication style to lead with more excellence, said Dr. Benny Rodriguez, a clinical psychologist and master coach. Providing clarity and building trust, choosing commitment to strategy and effective communication techniques that promote productive dialogue, better decision-making, and being able to effectively influence others are just a few of the behavioral changes we have seen in our clients and teams, reported Lori Harris of Harry Whitesell Consulting, LLC. There is no better way to assist with the process of improving communication and teamwork, stated Larry N. Long, Ph.D., an organizational development advisor with Berkshire Hathaway Energy. It wasn't long before the growing list of qualitative testimonials evolved into quantitative data on how communication intelligence as measured and developed by the Forte system, translates into solid business outcomes, productivity, profitability, engagement, and retention. Over more than 40 years, upward of 6,000 businesses and 6 million people have used Forte to bring better communication, better collaboration, and better results to their business and truly find their team's voice. Our story has become part of theirs. I want the same for you. Your communication intelligence journey. First, an invitation to take a free Forte communication style survey. As noted, it takes about 8 minutes, much shorter than most surveys or assessments. Simply go to https://www.fortecq.com/survey and complete the survey. A report will be emailed to you that details your communication style, strengths, and more. You will also have the opportunity for a feedback session with a Forte communication coach. Please note that this is optional. This book will lead and guide you whether or not you have taken the online assessment. It's about you. Even if you have never invested the time to learn about your communication strengths and how to be your best at work, you have started this book. Congratulations! Your communication intelligence journey has begun or is entering a new phase. In the chapters ahead, you will identify where you rank today on a novice to intermediate to mastery continuum of communication intelligence, and you will establish your goals. Discover your unique communication strengths. Develop strategies that will help you to adapt to be your best at work. Document motivators and demotivators that influence how you communicate on a daily basis. Review more than 100 strategies and tips that you can prioritize to improve your communication intelligence practices as they become productive and welcome habits. How to use this book. No matter where you are on the communication intelligence journey today, this book is designed to be a resource and to support you along the way. Here are a few tips. First of all, have fun. You will be learning about yourself and others and how to communicate more effectively. You will invest time and energy in your most valuable asset, you. This should be an enjoyable experience. Invest the time to understand the key points of each chapter and consider how they relate to your personal challenges and opportunities at work, today and in the future. Take action by completing the exercises. Research shows that results occur when you document goals in writing. There are dedicated spaces in the book to capture your commitments, thoughts, and outcomes. Of course, you can also keep a separate journal. Consider inviting an accountability partner. This is a person you can share your goals, progress, and challenges with. It could be someone you work with, a friend outside of work, or someone you like and respect inside or outside of work. Research shows that there are levels of commitment that increase the probability of your achieving a goal. For example, if you have a general idea of a goal, you are 10% likely to achieve it. When you have a written plan, you are 50% likely to accomplish the goal. With an accountability partner with whom you have specific check-in conversations, you are 95% more likely to achieve your objectives. Don't be surprised if, as your communication intelligence practices evolve into habits, you start to experience the world of work and those around you a little differently. For example, you are likely to become more sensitive to the communication preferences, strengths, and styles of those you interact with. The way people relate to each other may have more significance for you. Your evolution may also begin to influence those around you. Others not only may start commenting about how you seem more confident and calmer, but may even become curious about what you are doing. They may look at you as a resource for how they can improve their communication intelligence. As on any journey, there may be hills and valleys, and ups and downs. each and every step is a learning process that will bring you closer to being your best and to bringing your best to work through communication intelligence. Enjoy the ride. Part 1. Being Your Best. Your Communication Intelligence Strengths. Chapter 1. What is Communication Intelligence? Communication without intelligence has less value. Intelligence without communication misses out on value. Communication plus intelligence equals immense value. Is it possible to exaggerate the importance of communication? I don't think so, because communication is the very essence of what it means to be human. From the day we are born until the day we die, communication in its broadest and most miraculous sense permeates all that we are and all that we can be. The fact that we choose how to communicate is a reflection of our identity, provides opportunities for growth, and is an ongoing and personal experience. It is how we share information and leverage words, symbols, and sounds to connect the sender and the receiver. Communication, or the lack thereof, has started wars and established peace. It is embedded in the language of love and great art, music, literature, and inventions. It defies time and defines history. It has saved lives and helped souls soar. It allows for the beginning and building of relationships, as well as leads to their destruction and fall. Effective communication enables communities of all sizes and types to be supported and strong, while ineffective and poor communication practices can leave communities undermined and weak. It is also how we talk to ourselves. Seriously, what is the voice inside your head saying at this moment? Can you imagine a world without communication? Living as we know it simply wouldn't exist. So instead, let's imagine a world of work with more effective communication. Communication is one of the most critical competencies to have in a work context, but many individuals and organizations take it for granted since it's a natural part of the human experience. There are those who dismiss it as a touchy-feely, nice-to-have aspect of business and not as valuable as, for example, technical expertise. It is serious business. That's where communication intelligence, also known as CQ, comes in. Communication plus intelligence equals CQ. When you Google the term communication intelligence, the first returns you'll see are associated with intelligence gathering, a country's intel capabilities, as in the military or espionage arena. The discipline involves collecting information from a variety of sources, analyzing it, and shaping it into timely, relevant, and accurate intelligence with the goal of ensuring a nation's national security. Obviously, this is not the communication intelligence we are talking about. Still, CQ in a general work context involves similar discipline and rigor. It is underscored by research and science. It is essential to secure your professional goals. CQ builds on the idea that we are multidimensional beings and are not defined solely by IQ, intelligence quotient. The trillion-dollar differentiator. Is there evidence that communication has an impact on employees and businesses beyond qualitative stories and anecdotes? The answer is yes. A 2022 study conducted by Grammarly, the cloud-based company dedicated to helping improve written communication, in partnership with the Harris Poll, studied the impact of poor communication on U.S. work. The result is that an estimated $1.2 trillion is lost annually because of ineffective communication. Findings include the following. Almost all, 96%, business leaders say that effective communication is pivotal for delivering expected business results. Almost 3 in 4, 74%, say their company underestimates the cost of poor communication. Over 90% of leaders report that ineffective communication negatively impacts morale, productivity, and growth. It contributes to increased costs, leads to missed or extended deadlines, and harms reputations. The majority of employees, 86%, report having challenges with communication at work, and the primary impact is elevated stress. Poor communication is also the primary reason that businesses lose customers. The losing factors include employees being rude, complaints not being acknowledged, and customers feeling they have to repeat requests for assistance without adequate answers being provided to address their issues or solve their problems. Too many times, leaders believe they have clearly communicated these very things, from the mission and vision statement down to the important information that customer-facing teams need to know. Yet this study clearly confirms that there is so much more to be done. With proper applications of CQ, this is not how it has to be. CQ benefits. On the upside, there are multiple positive benefits of CQ for individuals, teams, and organizations. For individuals. Individuals who commit to mastering CQ enrich their own lives. They also have the potential to inspire and mentor those who may not have had the opportunity to achieve their communication potential through no fault of their own. In addition to the internal satisfaction that is likely to result as you pursue CQ, there are qualitative and quantitative benefits. And this applies whether you are a full-time employee, a part-timer, a gig worker, or a student, or whether you are on sabbatical or are retired and considering work options. When you advance your CQ capabilities, a few of the benefits include the following: being more believable and convincing as a speaker, and being able to negotiate more effectively, having the tools to prevent and resolve conflicts in a productive manner and achieve mutual understanding, experience less stress and frustration, broadening your access to job and business opportunities, feeling more valued as talents and accomplishments are recognized, evolving into the go-to person when others have questions or comments. This is not an overnight happening. Rather, it begins with self-awareness and the realization that it typically is not so much who you are, but how you adapt to others in any given situation. For teams. There are a variety of teams in a work context, and most of us belong to more than one. Over the course of your career, you are likely to serve on core or functional teams, cross-functional teams, project teams, self-directed teams, informal teams, leadership teams, and virtual or hybrid teams. If you are self-employed or are a contractor or consultant, your team may consist of you and a client. In a family-owned business, relatives may be the core team. With enhanced CQ, here are just a few of the benefits that teams experience: stronger relationships among team members and a shorter path to performing teams, a greater sense of shared purpose and team member loyalty, the ability to build support for initiatives. Ultimately, trusting relationships occur because what was promised by each individual was delivered and the team goals were achieved. For organizations. Organizations of all sizes and sectors, whether those organizations are public, private, or nonprofit, benefit from establishing a culture of effective communication. A few benefits are listed here: more engaged, productive employees and improved morale and retention, enhanced reputation in the community and marketplace, more loyal customers and new business opportunities, a healthier and more accepting work environment where employees feel they are welcome and respected, a healthier bottom line through minimizing costs due to poor communication. It is always a constructive mix of these elements, yet they are the clear result of intentional personal and interpersonal development. No fairy dust sprinkled across the workplace. Intentional is the operative word. Ineffective and effective CQ behaviors. The good news is that we can all learn to improve our communication intelligence abilities if we are willing and interested in doing so. To begin, we must understand what distinguishes ineffective and effective communication behaviors. Two essential elements for CQ proficiency are self-awareness and situational awareness. Self-awareness is the ability to understand your communication strengths. It allows you to understand clearly how others perceive you. This requires your stepping outside of traditional boundaries and observing yourself in action. Situational awareness is the ability to recognize what is happening in the environment around you and with other people you are interacting with or are in contact with. With these levels of awareness, individuals with high CQ learn to adapt their behavior so that their intended meaning aligns with what the receiver understands. Let's consider two hypothetical examples. Example 1. Someone who is a novice in communication may prepare for a sales presentation without understanding who the people in the audience are and what their needs could be. She presents the features of her product as her company defines them, instead of in terms of the customer's needs, expecting a positive response. The meaning is not received as intended, and the answer to the sales proposition is a solid no. Example 2. A colleague who is more proficient in CQ prepares for the meeting through researching and understanding the audience members in terms of their preferred communication styles and the business environment they are operating in. He invests time to build relationships. He explains how his product is a solution and opportunity for the customer. This communicator adapts his behavior during the session to ensure the intended meaning is aligned with what the receivers understand. The presentation results in a solid yes to the sale. The following outlines some additional behaviors associated with more effective and less effective communication. As you listen, ask yourself, do some of these behaviors resonate with me more than others? Behaviors of ineffective communication. Does not choose to adapt behavior based on the situation. Intended meaning does not align with others' perception. Does not ask good questions. For example, relies on those that lead to a yes or no answer. Does not follow up when he says he will. Does not keep his word. Ineffective listening. Focuses on negative, inaccurate messages. Does not inspire confidence. Behaviors of CQ. Intentionally adapts behavior based on the situation. Intended meaning usually aligns with others' perception. Asks good questions, for example, open-ended questions that provide for greater thought and understanding. Always follows up, keeps his word. Proactive listening. Focuses on positive, accurate messages. Inspires confidence. CQ in action. The test is how the behaviors play out in the real world. Some might think it's no big deal if, for example, you're not situationally aware, that you don't ask questions, or you don't follow up when you say you will. But to others, it is a big deal. In fact, not being situationally aware can limit or derail a career, relationship, and the list could go on. This is why clear expectations are critical to CQ. From all parties concerned. Let's consider two eating establishments. One is characterized by less than effective communication behaviors, while the other is characterized by high levels of communication intelligence. In addition, Restaurant A and Restaurant B are located in the same region, and they have similar menus and comparable pricing. Restaurant A. When you enter the establishment, you hear the sounds of silence. Where are the customers? An employee greets you, eventually, and, to say the least, doesn't look happy to be there. She barely makes eye contact, checks the clock on the wall, and vaguely answers your questions. When you ask for water, she says it'll be right up. It never arrives. You notice that she appears to glare at another customer when he asks for the check. It doesn't take long for you to decide to leave and check out the establishment down the street. Restaurant B. You drive into the parking lot and see a line of people curling out the door. They are clearly enjoying themselves. An associate is outside welcoming customers, handing out menus, promising an exceptional dining experience, smiling, and answering questions. In a short time, you enter the obviously popular establishment where soft and appropriate music enlivens the atmosphere. You are immediately greeted, shown to a seat, and introduced to your wait person for the evening. She clearly loves her job and makes you feel like the most important customer in the world. Orders are taken, and the food is delivered with a flair and tastes delicious. When it's time to leave, you are warmly thanked and invited back. You leave a generous tip and can't wait to return and ask your friends to join you. Would you be surprised if I shared that Restaurant A is out of business and that franchisers are interested in Restaurant B's expansion potential? The reason that customers turned away from Restaurant A is that the staff didn't connect with the customers. You may have had the experience of superb food contrasted with subpar service when dining out. The customers in this case experienced less than acceptable personal or interpersonal communication, and that led to the restaurants closing its doors. The growing criticality of communication. The nature of how we engage in work has been evolving for years. Long gone is the notion of working for a single organization for a number of decades and then retiring. The average worker will change jobs 12 times. A number of familiar jobs today likely will not exist in 10 years due to advances in technology and work efficiencies. About 150 years ago, in 1876, Alexander Graham Bell was the first to be granted a patent for what was to become known as the telephone. In 1945, the first modern computer, known as the Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer, was put to use by the U.S. Army with a development cost of almost $6 million in today's currency. The first computer-to-computer message, that is, email, was sent in 1969. Then came the World Wide Web, invented by Tim Berners-Lee, a British scientist, in 1989. The first smartphone was developed by IBM in 1994. The power of the technology we use to communicate is growing at a staggering pace. Today, most information is digital and has never been more plentiful. I wonder what Bell, Berners-Lee, and other pioneers would say about the amount of information that is processed every second. Consider these statistics. More than 347 billion emails are sent each day. Around 6 billion texts are sent every day. Approximately 2.5 quintillion bytes of data are created every day. The challenge today is not whether we have access to information. The critical element is how we process and communicate what we choose to access. The novice to mastery continuum. A best practice when it comes to developing CQ is to consider it as a journey with varying levels of proficiency along the way. A competency in a development context defines a combination of knowledge, skills, abilities, traits that adds up to being able to perform on the job. The level of being competent is how well you are able to perform the behaviors at work. Not everyone is competent at the same level or at the same time. If everyone were, then Pulitzer Prize-winning author Toni Morrison would be just another competent writer. Widely acclaimed cellist Yo-Yo Ma would be just another competent musician. In terms of the competency of communication, many who want to improve have high expectations. Allow me to introduce a construct that I believe will be useful to guide you on your CQ journey. Like many other professionals, you may find it so practical and easy to understand that you may proactively use it in a variety of development opportunities and share it with others. It's called the novice to intermediate to mastery continuum. It builds on the concept that we are all at some point along the CQ developmental journey. How we are advancing is defined by observable behaviors. Review the following levels and relate to them. They will provide a benchmark for your CQ journey. 1. Level, novice. A novice is, by definition, one who is relatively new to a field or competency, has less experience than other colleagues, and may have had fewer opportunities to learn and develop. People at this level may be challenged in even routine situations as they figure out how to apply knowledge to achieve results. Novices also are likely to be eager to improve and grow, and therefore may have a faster learning curve than others. 2. Level, intermediate. Those at an intermediate level behave competently in routine or predictable situations. They have command of words, symbols, and technologies. They may not understand why their message isn't always received by others in the way they intend it. 3. Level, mastery. Those who are closer to mastery understand their communication strengths and those of others. They adapt their behavior based on different situations so that meaning aligns with what is being received. They are lifelong learners and never stop trying to communicate in clearer, more consistent, and impactful ways. They also are able to help others learn and understand. Your CQ opportunity. What if you had the opportunity to be your best at CQ, which is the essential competency for success at work and life, and which is more important now than ever? That is your opportunity. No matter how you have previously conceived of communication, I hope that it resonates that the opportunity and impact reach far beyond words and symbols. I hope you are inspired to make better choices for yourself, which will expand your networks and improve the corporate and community practice of others. To start with, I'd like to ask you where you currently are on a continuum of understanding and practice of communication intelligence. As you know, you can't plan a journey unless you know where you're starting. Building on the earlier discussion, do you see yourself today as a communication intelligence novice, intermediate, or master? Remember what I described in the introduction about working at a TV station? Believe me, when I was a young 20-something working at that TV station, I was probably less than a novice. Take a moment to complete the first exercise found in the bonus PDF for this audiobook. Now that you have a starting point for your communication intelligence journey, what are your objectives for where you would like to be by the time you finish the book and beyond? These objectives don't have to be specific or SMART goals at this point. SMART goals are goals that are specific, measurable, actionable, realistic, and time-bound. Please write two or three, or more, if they are on top of mind, descriptors of what you would like to achieve. CQ bonus. Have you invited an accountability partner to share the CQ journey with you? As noted in the introduction, this could be someone you work with, a friend outside of work, or someone else you like and respect. Research shows that with such an ally, you are 95% more likely to achieve your objectives. What's next? Congratulations on starting your unique CQ journey. The next stage is building your CQ self-awareness. In the chapter ahead, you are invited to discover your unique communication strengths. Chapter 2. What are my unique communication strengths? There is no good or bad, right or wrong, or strong or weak. It's just how you roll. I invite you to meet retired Colonel Rob Campbell, who served in the U.S. Army for 28 years and is currently a successful leadership executive. He is grateful to those he served with and for what he learned in the service, but like many military personnel, he found it challenging to transition to civilian life, or what he terms an encore life. As he explains, when you go into the military, you don't have an identity. The military tells you who you are. It's all issued to you. Then when you come out, you have a blank sheet of paper, and it's the first time in your professional life that you have to figure out what you should do. Colonel Campbell is clear about the first step to transitioning in any professional or personal capacity. It's self-awareness, introspection, knowing yourself. When Campbell left the Army in 2016, His initial attempt at starting a consulting business was a rough ride, so he considered casting the business aside and becoming a financial advisor for military personnel. "I'm not a details guy, and I'm not a numbers guy," he says, explaining why finance wasn't a good fit. Then the retired colonel took the Forte Communication Style Survey to determine his communication style and strengths. Here's what he shared about this significant step. "People think I'm a dominant person because I was in the military and I was a colonel, but I'm not. I'm a non-dominant person at my core, and it's important to know that so I don't step into a role that requires me to be dominant, extrovert, impatient, and conformist. Because I'm the opposite in all those respects, I can adapt, but it's going to take energy from me. I have to fill my bucket in other places. And this is where I can help someone else transitioning out of the military. I can say to someone, 'You're introverted. That's your strength. This role you're describing, it seems to me you're going to need to be very extroverted. So my caution to you is, find those places where you can be introverted, where you can close the door, get some quiet time, fill your tank back up, so you're not unhappy at the end of the day.'" Rob is a perfect example of overcoming even self-stereotyping through knowing his true strengths have little to do with earned rank in the military. He is one of the finest leaders I know from his consultative approach, utilizing this self-awareness to situational awareness solutions. Join the Self-Awareness Club. You are invited to join a unique club of those people who are genuinely self-aware. Organizational psychologist Tasha Urick and her team conducted groundbreaking research over 4 years on the topic of self-awareness, what it is, why we need it, and how we can grow more self-aware. The findings are that 95% of us believe that we are self-aware, while only 10 to 15% of us truly are. That means that about 80% of us may be going about our day-to-day activities in a sort of self-delusion. There are two factors that distinguish those who are in the more aware club. One is being internally aware, understanding, for example, our own tendencies and values. And the other is being externally aware, understanding how others see and perceive us. Where are you now? Just as we discussed earlier, it's so beneficial to get a minimum baseline of where we are before we work on improving. Where are you now in understanding your CQ strengths? Fill out the next exercise found in the bonus PDF. In this chapter, you will develop an understanding of self-awareness and its importance in more effective communication. Take the CQ survey to discover your communication.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.